It's a pleasure to welcome longtime supporters, new friends, and so many of our trustees. I'm also pleased that my predecessor, Bonnie Burnham, who led World Monuments Fund for 30 years, is with us tonight. We're thrilled that this year, our annual Paul Mellon Lecture will be delivered by the amazing global photographer, Ewan Baum. Ewan's path and mine first crossed in 2009, when Robert Hammond and I were opening the first phase of the High Line. And architects Liz Diller and Rick Scafidio, who are here with us this evening, brought Ewan in to photograph the just-finished park. Like many artists commissioned to document new architectural works, Ewan delivered a portfolio of stunningly composed photos that showed the site before it opened, empty of people, images that brought forward the brilliance of the park's design. But the most powerful images Ewan gave us came from subsequent visits. After the park opened, images that showed it alive with people, strolling with families, lounging in the sun, playing with children, photos that illustrated the High Line's true spirit as a social place of public, democratic gathering and interaction. Tonight, we will have the pleasure of looking at some of the most interesting places in the world from Ewan's perspective, which inevitably zeroes in on the complex and moving relationships between built spaces and the people who bring them to life. This empathetic, essentially human perspective is vital to our work at World Monuments Fund. We've built a reputation conserving the world's most beautiful sites using the field's best practices, which will awe you when you visit the temples of Angkor in Cambodia, or the Forbidden City in Beijing, or Chanquio, the oldest solar observatory in the Americas, in Peru. An art historical, scientific, and aesthetic approach will always be the foundation of our conservation fieldwork, but it is when we use that foundation to build long-term sustainability that our work has its most lasting and meaningful impacts. This means looking deeper than the bricks and mortars of a place to its human dimension. The historic sites we all love sprung from the human imagination, were made with human hands to meet the most basic and the most exalted human needs, which is why our conservation work involves investments in people, in community capacity, through training, advocacy, documentation, and other tools that give local stakeholders the power they need to steward treasured sites in the future and build stronger communities around them. To realize the full potential of a site of meaning, we look to its people as the ultimate source of its power. This is why Ewan's vision is such an inspiration to us. To introduce Ewan now, I'm going to turn you over to Justin Davidson. Justin is the author of Magnetic City, A Walking Companion to New York, which leads readers through a portrait of the city told through history, architecture, music, art, and literature. He has been the architecture and classical music critic at New York Magazine since 2007. Before that, he spent 12 years as a music critic and architecture writer at Newsday. He won a Pulitzer Prize for criticism in 2002, among many other distinguished awards. Ladies and gentlemen, friends, please join me in welcoming Justin Davidson.
Thank you, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here and delight to introduce Ewan Baum, who is an architectural photographer. He takes pictures of buildings primarily for a living. And I would guess that many of you in this room, like me, are amateur architectural photographers. We show up and we take our little snapshots. And I have thought about what it is that distinguishes the pictures that you and I take from the pictures that he takes, which seem like they belong in a really completely different realm. And I think I've thought about it through the lens of a writer, because I write about architecture, and he takes pictures about architecture. And in some ways, what we both wrestle with is an aspect of architecture that's the most difficult thing to confront and to understand, which is time. Because you can look at a building as a form, and that's what generally I certainly do when I take a snapshot. It's just present there in front of me, a picture. But that's not how we experience buildings any more than we experience the other art that I write about, which is music. You can't take a picture of a piece of music. You can't experience it in a second. There's no such thing as a snapshot of music. And in some way, a snapshot of a piece of architecture is also a falsification or an impossibility. Because when you actually experience architecture, it takes time to see it, to see different sides of a building, to understand its presence in the landscape, to move through it, to sense. It's a full body sensual experience to sense the way it smells, the way it feels to move through it, the way the light surrounds you. And then over time, as the building ages, the experience of using it, of being in it, whether it's a museum or an office building or what have you. And that, to me, is the key to what Iwan does, is that he shows us buildings, and here he will show us not the contemporary buildings that I'm used to seeing him photograph, but a whole other range of historical sites. But he shows us those buildings as they are experienced, both by the people who use them and from these impossible vantage points that you can't actually ever obtain unless, like him, you rent a helicopter and fly and see it from above. But what that does is it permits him to distance himself from the object and see it as a living presence in a context. So for instance, the way he shoots Michael Maltzen's social housing in LA as this kind of beacon in a gray part of the city, and implying sort of metaphorically the way it is a beacon of hope for the people who live there. Or sometimes just formally, like Grace Farms in New Canaan, Connecticut, with this sinuous shape in the landscape, and you feel it like sort of sneaking through the terrain. But then just as often coming in close and showing you the human dimension of a piece of architecture, most memorably to me, his pictures of the Torre David in Caracas, where he spent some time talking to and photographing and really investigating the lives that had come to occupy this unfinished, unglassed-in bank tower that was abandoned mid-construction and became a place that people simply occupied and created lives, created businesses. And there was this whole society, vertical society, that flourished in this tower and that he documented. But one of the most memorable pictures for me personally, because I write about New York, is a photograph, an indelible photograph that he took in the few days after Hurricane Sandy hit New York in October 29th, 2012. And I remember that well because I write for New York Magazine, and we had an issue to put out, as we did at that point every week. And Monday, the day that the storm hit, is the day that, you know, you start to finish up that week's issue and move towards the Friday close. So all the stories had been assigned. I had something I was supposed to write and file. Then the hurricane hits Monday evening. Tuesday, nobody can reach anybody else. It's impossible to get to the office. There's no transit. There's no electricity. There are no phones. But it never occurred to anybody not to put out a magazine. So it wasn't, I think, until Tuesday afternoon or maybe even Wednesday morning that a group of editors managed to get together in a borrowed office that somehow still had power. And I contributed my story, and I was impressed by my colleague's ability to put together a magazine. It wasn't until I saw the print edition and looked at the cover that I understood what the magazine was able to be that week, which was a chronicle of a city in extreme emergency, but also a really inspiring collection of stories about that go deeply into the heart of what the city is. And all of that was captured by a cover image by Iwan, who had somehow managed to wrangle a helicopter and fly above the city and take a picture of darkened New York, the only lit part of it being in Battery Park City that had managed to stay lit. And it was an instantaneously obvious image of New York, of emergency, of resilience, of vulnerability, of the life that the city had that was latent, because you could sort of sense the teeming quality of the city in all of those dark streets. And it was just a marvelous, indelible image. And what to me remains amazing about it and all of Iwan's work is that sense of being above everything and inside it at the same time. There was no question that this was not just your ordinary aerial shot of a city, but an aerial shot by a photographer who really knew, really understood what the life on the street was like and who those people were down there who were living the life that he was able to see from above. And that is an extraordinary, I think, feat of not just of technique and of timing and of being present, but also of empathy, which I think runs to the heart of everything Iwan does. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to, ladies and gentlemen, Iwan Bon. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming tonight, and thanks for the invitation to speak here. The first slide, you've seen it already. I want to show you a few things. Like, this was kind of the start of my career, so to say, in architecture. I met Rem Koolhaas about 13 years ago, and coming from a background of documentary photography, I proposed him to start documenting the construction of CCTV, the big tower in Beijing, and which I've been doing over the last 13 years. It's basically still not finished. But that was one of these projects where I could really show how these sort of new monuments are almost built and how they become part of a city and part of a place and become a kind of identity of a place. So over the last 13 years, I worked with many of the great architects sort of documenting these new urban projects, and I'm really fascinated how they become part of a city. Like here, the High Line, this literally this line through the city, and that's how I met Joshua also about a decade ago. I came yesterday back from Doha, Qatar, and these sort of completely new built cities out of nothing, out of the sand, literally. Rem Koolhaas, who is finishing there, this new library, one of these massive new urban and cultural projects there in the city. Really spectacular projects which are going up everywhere. So my focus, my interest has been always this mix, documentary work, architecture, and how people live really in these places. A book which I published about 8 years ago on Brasilia and Chandigarh, showing how these cities were built like by a singular architect, Le Corbusier, and Oscar Niemeyer, and how these places sort of evolved over a period of 50, 60 years. And I'm fascinated how people live in these places, how they take it over, how these places changes. Like here, one of these canopies under the buildings where all the notaries sort of start to set up their businesses, start to work. And yeah, these architectural icons become sort of everyday background really in a city. Sort of incredible offices where you stumble into, which is always great as a photographer. You have always a reason to sort of knock on someone's door and peek inside. Here, Brasilia, also this aerial shot where you really see how the city was planned and built as this bird shape city with a central axis and all the living quarters around it. And how this, icons which we know from an architecture point of view also really become this background for the people, their everyday lives, how they really live in these places. And then it's Brazil, so there's always sort of a half-naked guy walking around. So, and it's nice also like to really experience these places and see, spend some time there, see it through the days, through the rain, through the sun, and all these different atmospheres. And like great architecture can also look really great when in the pouring rain or under these other conditions. This was a project I did 2 years ago in Russia, Ekaterinburg, also called the largest open-air constructivist museum, basically. city which was built in the 1920s, 1930s, and was really this like showcase for constructivist architects. The large post office in the center of the city. And yeah, these places, they're nowadays quite run down, but still at the same time very much in use, like the sports center was nicely painted, crumbling on the other side, but still, like, it's an everyday place where people come and do their things. And then you step into all these different worlds, the dance classes in one of the cultural centers, and the people who are there doing their everyday things, just the sort of everyday things on the street, this woman who runs her little eating stand, and everything is sort of perfectly color coordinated from her belt to the advertisements. And of course, the Burger King came in right in front of the National Bank, the central bank there. The kids who hang out around there in their American, full American shirts and so on. But the city was built around the industry, the factories, and the workers who lived there. So there's these massive housing complexes everywhere around the city, right next to the factories, so people were living close to where they're working and having their lives. This was one of the monuments. They're still in the city in a deplorable state, but that was the first concrete building in Russia, I believe, and it was the water tower there for the city. So that was in use from the 1920s to the 1970s. At that time it was abandoned, and now it's just a hangout for kids who spray paint, who climb up and sort of hang out on top of the city. About 4 years ago, I started with Manuel Hertz, professor at the ETH in Zurich, on a big journey through Africa, documenting African modernism. We made this book documenting five countries all over Africa who were just in that moment of transformation to independence. And as part of their nation building post-independence, hired mainly foreign architects to build sort of their landmarks, their cities, their universities, cultural buildings, etc. Here we're in Abidjan, Ivory Coast, and this is one of these. This pyramid, golden pyramid building, which was really like a center icon of the city. Nowadays, largely neglected, people are living in there. It was an office building, and now it's been squatted and kind of falling apart. And people, there's talk that the building will be torn down. Like a lot of these projects are torn down these days and making place for the newest glass tower, which is like now the symbol of new prosperity for these countries. But then there's of course also really nice examples like this hotel in Abidjan, which is very nicely preserved and well in use. And right in front of it, there's this conference center, which has been like renovated, but unfortunately in a sort of plastic skin wrapped. And but you still see the outlines and the ideas of the architect there. But these cities, like, they're full of these modernist architectural gems, the housing communities, but also like the sort of everyday shops you stumble upon. Like office buildings, the city centers, and how they all were built. Ivory Coast, when they became independent, they moved the capital to the center of the city. They had this kind of similar idea, like Brasilia and Chandigarh, or like the Brasilia, that they would move the capital to the center of the country. This new city, Yamoussoukro, nowadays still a lot of empty highways, big city planning, which never really took off. But there's also some really beautiful gems, like this school and university with many sort of these sports buildings. And all this work has never really looked at before, so it was really fascinating to have this discovery through these countries. And this is the presidential palace there in Yamoussoukro. They have a large canal around it, and their natural defense in the canal too, for the president. And then there's an exact copy they built of the Vatican, and they thought, you see it here in the city with the slums in front of it. And then the building there, they thought the actual Vatican was a little bit too small, so they enlarged it all 1.5 times and made it this huge, oversized Vatican with inside the columns there's elevators going up, and so it's kind of strange. Here we are in Senegal, beautiful housing projects everywhere. It's always nice to see how these places get used and changed, and all the nice modernist louvers become storage spaces for people to put their things in. And there's this fantastic exhibition center in the outskirts of Senegal. Everything modeled on this triangle, which goes into every little detail from the large master plan to the interiors where people also live, and where still sometimes these exhibitions are held, but also a big storage facility basically for the city became. The university, so in all these countries, many of these large civic buildings which we became really the centerpieces for the city. This is Zambia, Lusaka. They call it also the Los Angeles of Africa. Basically, the only similarity I found was sort of the endless flatness of the city, basically. There's one street, Cairo Street, which has these beautiful modernist towers for the National Central Bank, some government buildings, and that's sort of the center of the city. Universities, there's this fantastic student housing project, all out of brick, very Louis Kahn inspired, where 2 or 3 students in these tiny rooms huddled together, but a nice open air interior atrium space where the people cook and have their sort of social life there. The DVD shop where I stumbled upon, where sort of everything is DVDs and Rambo and the action movies. The universities, the parliament building here of Zambia. So we focused for this first book on, where the parliament has their seat between the giant tusks and the lion. Kenya, Nairobi, the capital, with the Kenyatta Center, which was until the early 2000s the tallest building on the African continent. Mainly office building, all the senators have their seat in there, beautiful view over the city there. And there's this large space here where the Senate comes together in the middle. The bus stop in Nairobi is this sort of endless circle of buses coming in and out, which is like a whirlpool sort of moving all day around. And there was this fantastic nightclub sitting on a pedestal, one of these modernist icons of the city, really, which was the second time when I visited, it was demolished already. It was built after the traditional Kenyan housing, the circular house. And behind it, there's this beautiful market, which reminded me a little bit to the market hall, this new building from this Dutch architects MVRDV in Rotterdam, who built a kind of exact copy almost of it. Here you see it inside. And these markets are always fascinating. They're on the continent, like hustle and bustle and sort of fully in use. And you see also like how these projects with very minimal means could be built. Like here, it's just these simple concrete parasols, but they work fantastically already for over half a century often. And people really being part of everything they sell, their whole being and everything there. So I always try to make an effort of going a number of times a year there to the continent, and not only for contemporary work or the modernist things, but on these travels I try to visit also historic places, like here in Ghana. This is in the north of Ghana, the Larabanga Mosque. It's also called the Mecca of Africa. It was one of the central places for Muslim Africa to come together there. A place which had been sort of restored in the 1970s, but in a very poor way. Like it's this mud building from the 15th century, I believe. And like in the 70s, they restored it with a kind of concrete slab around it. And of course, all the mud inside sort of washed away. There was only a sort of concrete shell there in the World Monuments Fund. Took over there and trained people to use that mud structure and teach them again to keep it up, that work and these traditional skills to bring that back. And it's really beautiful to see that, how it's still like really the center of the city. Like there's every day the markets, the big celebrations and things happening all around there. And it's still very much a place, like even after so many centuries, like really a place where people come together. Close to there, I wanted to see these houses, which were built in a very specific way. Like when you've entered these villages, like basically the only thing you see is a large mud wall, and there's no entrance, no windows, no doors or anything, and then someone leads you up to a little ladder, and then actually you see that the whole circulation of the whole village is on the roof of these houses. So people first go to the roof of the house, and then they walk to their own house, to the house of their neighbors, and etc. So every house has a large courtyard in the middle, where from the roof you descend into. So it was a kind of natural defense system of keeping animals out and to keep a village like that secure. There must have been hundreds of these villages all over the north of Ghana, but when we were there a couple of years ago, most of them were actually falling apart and largely not in use anymore. So it's really sad to see these traditional building techniques disappearing so quickly. And of course, that mud that needs a lot of work and upkeep. But at the same time, like it's material they just get out of the ground. They can treat with their own hands. They don't need to buy or import anything. And they can build their own homes with very minimal cost and efforts. This is in the north of Togo, the Batamabia houses, one of the first examples of multi-story mud housing. These houses, they were always divided in a male and a female part for the men and the women to live in different parts of the house. The entrance, the door, looks really like a face, always like two eyes and a big mouth where you sort of step into. And the whole, these houses, the towers were actually built for to store the grains and food and so high up. And then the houses is this whole circular pattern inside of different rooms on different stories where daily life happened. Here we're in China, these incredible Tulu houses in the south of China. There's this whole area where until recently, like hundreds of thousands of people lived in these large communal houses, also like a sort of a defense system, these big circular houses where many families live together. Inside, it's all made out of wood. A number of stories in the middle. There's often a sort of communal kitchen. And still, these places are very much in use. People live there, although it's also a UNESCO World Heritage Site nowadays. So people, tourists visit them, but a place very much in use and full of life. Then you walk around there and someone sort of thinks you want something to eat and points at the chicken, and a few minutes later the chicken is there and the guy in his suit on his phone is also sort of making the chicken for you. This is another incredible place in the north of China. These underground houses, and until recently literally millions of people lived there in these self-built carved out houses in the earth. The whole region is known for its loess soil, so it's a very soft kind of sand-like soil. So people could easily sort of dig out a place, and like here you see it from above actually, how sort of all these courtyards are dug out, like there's little staircases going into every courtyard and people live down there. It's like the rooms sort of stick into the earth. So that whole landscape, you see sort of people disappearing into the ground. And yeah, I was asking people like, why do people build their houses like that? And it was like, yeah, for them, the most logical thing, like they said, like we never had money basically to buy materials to build a house. So the most logic way was basically remove materials and create a space through that. And still, like there's quite some places which are well used and people still live in there, but also like, nowadays the government is trying to get people out there and they think it's unsafe. People need to keep it up and otherwise it sort of falls apart also. So slowly these places are also disappearing. But it's really fascinating to see these very specific ways people build places because of natural materials which are available, the local conditions. And like, yeah, for them it was the most logic thing to do. And you see that sort of logic of removing materials sort of everywhere in these communities. But then like once you step inside, like, yeah, they still put a poster of like a real living room in there. Sort of that's how they, maybe their ideal of living. But that idea of removing materials, yeah, you see it until the smallest details, like a small altar is not built up, but again, sort of carved out in the wall there, so that the whole concept goes into every detail. I stumbled on one of these very modern ones, like this woman with her fake Eames chair, the computer, and like a very comfortable life in their underground and kind of updated house. But also like, yeah, places like that disappear fast, like here, this guy who was being evicted, the big highway sort of coming over, and these places, yeah, become like a dump for the municipality, fill up and disappear, and that's sort of the new Chinese ideal which is arriving everywhere there out of the ground, and it's kind of sad to see. Here we are in Ethiopia, Lalibela. A kind of incredible place which I've wanted to visit for a long time. I went there a couple of years ago during Ethiopian Christmas. They have the Coptic calendar, so the Christmas is like depending on the moon, but usually kind of early January. And then it becomes like really a pilgrimage site for thousands and thousands of pilgrims who visit that site. From above, like it was a mountain which about 1,000 years ago they started to carve out all these churches out of the stone vertically down, so it's not like a Petra or these sites in Turkey, for instance, where they carved like into a cliff site, but they literally started to carve straight down and built this whole architecture also by removing materials. So that whole landscape is kind of completely altered landscape of these churches, which go meters and meters deep. And the sort of, here, these trenches, which go down and slowly open up in small doors at the bottom, where you actually enter these churches, which are like, the top is still the same as the ground level. So it was really special to be there during such a moment, like once a year, these thousands of pilgrims who come there, who slowly descend into the earth. Sometimes the steps are completely eroded, as you see here, and they built up a few stones, but still mainly the whole concept is just these spaces only by removing materials, a kind of almost negative architecture, where instead of building up, it's all by subtracting materials. People sort of descend into the earth there, walk through little tunnels and come out at the bottom of these churches where all the ceremonies happen and they do their prayers. You see, like, all the architecture is literally, yeah, these elements, everything is carved out. There's nothing added to it. Everything is just made by subtraction and this sort of idea of, what it should be. And then they start carving out all these spaces. Incredible sort of raw architecture and raw spaces. And it's not only on the outside, but these places have been hollowed out also. So inside, you step into a whole world where you're basically inside a complete stone. And also, like, all kind of architectural details come back, like these rows of columns to support the thing, but like these columns are not added again, but they're subtracted and taken out. Here you see these interior places. And then these kind of incredible voids going even further down into the earth, to give these spaces another spiritual meaning. Another place where I was, this was about 4 years ago, which was a long time on my list to visit, is the Ise Shrine in Japan. I've been working the last decade with many Japanese architects, and they always said, you have to see the Ise Shrine. It's sort of the golden ratio for architecture, in a way, for Japan. And the Ise Shrine, it's a place where about 1,500 years ago, they started to build these shrines. It's kind of the most holy place for the Shinto religion. So it's a very historic site, but at the same time, it's being completely rebuilt every 20 years. And I was there a couple of years ago during that moment the inauguration moment, basically, of these new shrines. The Ise Shrine, it's called the Ise Shrine, but it's actually two hills there, close to Osaka in Japan, where there's literally hundreds of shrines, from like little shrines, temples like this size, to big buildings are. And they're all on two identical sites next to each other. This one moment every 20 years, this was the moment that the spirits are transferred from the old to the new shrine. And it's like one of the big moments in Japan. So thousands of people come out there. The whole royal family is there, the prime minister. And it's one of the big moments for Japan, which happens then once every 20 years. But it's all the Shinto priests who transfer the spirits from the old to the new shrines. And it's also the one moment once every 20 years years that you see these old and new shrines sitting next to each other, like the old shrine kind of weathered and the new shrine brand new and completely built out of wood. There's no steel, no nails, nothing in there, so it's all wooden connections. So it's also a way to keep the tradition and the incredible wooden craftsmanship alive, and people who live in that whole traditions for many years and built up these shrines. So from those 20 years, there's this one moment where the old and the new sit next to each other. Then the old one gets demolished, and after about 12 years, they start slowly rebuilding an exact replica of the other shrine on the empty place. That takes about 8 years, and then 20 years later, there's this moment again where they transfer the spirits from the old to the new shrine. So it was a difficult thing to be there as an outsider and as a photographer. Like, it took many months to get the permission. Like, it's Japan, so it was many permissions you needed to get, and you're assigned to a very specific place to stand here and take pictures there. And many of these ceremonies happen completely behind closed doors, which no one outside the Shinto religion can see. And once you peek over a fence, like, where you're not allowed, like, that guy looked a little angry at me also. But an incredible place of architecture, tradition, which is constantly renewed, and that history of, like, a site of so many centuries, but which is still kept up to date in a way, in a kind of incredible way. And literally everything on site gets renewed. So, like, all the arches, the entries, the bridges, everything gets completely rebuilt every 20 years. And this was all during that ceremony. And also all the Shinto priests, they all come out with beautiful new clothes. Everything has to be completely new. It's this whole idea of this constant renewal, which comes back there. One of the last things I want to show, which is a complete opposite of these two last projects I wanted to show, is another religious ceremony which happens once every 12 years in India. It's the Kumbh Mela. And I was there about 4 or 5 years ago when that happened. It's the largest human gathering in the world. It's a place where during a period of about 6 weeks almost 100 million people come together in the north of India, where the Ganges and the Yamuna River come together. And usually there's a big lake, but they have this festival in the dry season, so most of the lake dries up, and in the middle of the lake there's this island coming out of the lake during dry season, kind of the size of Manhattan, where they built a whole temporary city, a mega city for these 100 million people. This city is built literally for these 6 weeks that these ceremonies are there, and like literally everyone from all over India comes there by buses, trains, and everything in. So it's kind of the most ephemeral idea of architecture, literally, which comes up and is after 6 weeks literally kind of washes away in the river. There's one permanent structure in that place, and it's this giant bridge which crosses the lake usually. You see, like, the level of the lake up here where the water is usually, and this is during dry season, so then it's all dry, and they built up this massive city. So every guru, baba, and religious person from India comes in there with their whole following, sets up camp. You have all these different camps, some like perfectly designed, others people just setting up a few fabrics and bamboo sticks, and built a small tent out of there. And it's literally this whole city sort of held up by fabrics, wires, and ropes. But at the same time, like, they really try to build architecture also. Like, all these buildings, like, they really have a front facade, like, as real architecture, but it's all built just by bamboo sticks covered with fabrics, and but really mimicking an actual building. Behind it is a large space where the community gathers and comes together. And every guru, Baba, and group, they all have sort of their own color schemes, designs, and lookout points. And it's just like layers and layers of these fabrics and colors. And like India is, of course, like an incredible example of all that. And then still, like, it's all just on the soil of the of the sand. There's no distinction really between inside and outside, but of course once you step into that religious inner circle, like, you still have to take off your shoes, and there you step into another world. These endless encampments where the people live and do their daily things, like, there's these fires which burn all day, so there's this thick atmosphere of smoke Indian smells everywhere, and these people who congregate there, and like the heads of these groups, like, they sometimes come by car, but like they park their car just at the beginning of the whole festival when there's still nothing, but then the car gets another layer of fabric around it and stays there for the next 6-8 weeks until they can probably drive out again. It's just like people, buildings, the floors, the ceilings, the walls, everything is just layers and layers of fabric, and you sort of move through that whole space like that. At night, it's a sort of total opposite experience. This was also the first time probably that it was so, like, literally kind of electrified. There was a massive electricity system they built in like 12 years before. That was 2001 when the previous one was there. It was much more primitive at the time. Like this time, like, everyone is walking around, of course, with cell phones, and so they need to charge. But also, like, everything was one big festival of lights, LEDs, blaring sound systems, like incredible sound where you could barely talk. And then this combination of all these sacred rituals, but at the same time, like, people on their cell phones and with all their modern communications happening there. And this was the guy who's in charge, basically, of all that electricity and had to keep it all running, this whole city of 100 million people. And I found it fascinating to see these three examples of, like, these rock-hewn churches, like sort of the most permanent kind of architecture, which is like 1,000 years old in a place like Ethiopia, which so many times over the last 1,000 years became from Christian to Muslim to all the kind of different faiths, where most of regular architecture gets destroyed in wars, but these kind of rock-hewn churches are, like, so permanent. There's nothing, like, what you can really do about it. Like the Issei Shrine, which is something like this tradition which gets renewed and renewed to, like, this city which gets built, like, literally a mega city. Built up for a period of 6 weeks, once every 12 years, and then literally get washed away. Thank you so much.